So thank you everyone for coming. Today I'm going to talk about the implementation of a multithreaded entity component system, a declarative entity component system where I'm going to specify a lot of settings and stuff at compile time. So everything is already available on GitHub on this page, the slides and the code. If you want to follow along or maybe check something in the code, which is quite well commented, you can just follow along on GitHub. My name is Vittorio Romeo. I'm a student at University of Messina, which is in Sicily. You may know me for some video tutorials that dive into C++ series. I'm also trying to stay active in the C++ community, and I've spoken at CppCon 2014 and 15. Last year, I spoke here at C++ Now, substituting a missing speaker, so it was an improvised talk. And I'm also working on a lot of open source projects, such as games and libraries. So in this talk, we're going to cover the entity component system pattern in general. Then we're going to cover my library, which is called ECST. We're going to look at the design and its features. We'll look at a complete usage example, a code example. Then the architecture of the library, like the various components of the library, its implementation, and some consideration for the future. So how many of you are familiar with the concept of entity component systems? Okay. So let's begin by trying to define what an entity is. So this is quite subjective. There is no strict definition. I think that an entity is something. Yeah?
It's not working. Is your battery dry or?
No.
Is it flat? Can it be flat?
Yeah.
Test, test. It's working?
Okay.
So. Sorry about that. So I was saying that defining an entity is not really formal. It's mostly subjective. I think that an entity is something that's tied to a real-world concept. Also, it has related data or logic. And we usually deal with many entities, but we may want to track specific instances of those entities. Entities can be created and destroyed. And some simple examples may be in the case of game development, maybe the game objects, such as the player, a bullet, or a car. Or maybe we're making a GUI library, and a window, a text box, or a button may be an entity.
It sounds to me like a node. How do you distinguish it from a node?
Well, I usually think about nodes like in a hierarchical structure. Well, an entity is not necessarily hierarchical.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we have various ways of encoding entities. The most primitive way, in my opinion, is the object-oriented inheritance. And what happens is that we create a hierarchy of classes. We have the base entity, then widget derives from the base entity. Then we add text box and button. In this case, the arrows are just showing the inheritance chains. And this is very easy to implement, but it's obviously cache unfriendly. You have runtime overhead because of virtual functions, and you lack flexibility. Data is stored inside the classes themselves, as logic is as well. So you usually have some methods in the base class and you override them in the other classes. The lack of flexibility is shown here. For example, we're making a game where we have a skeleton. We want the skeleton to have a sword or a shield. What happens if we want to make a skeleton with both a sword and a shield? We get into the commonly known diamond problem with inheritance. So it's pretty annoying. And it gets even worse by adding more classes and going deeper into the tree of the inheritance. This is what it looks like in code. We have like a struct, a base struct for the entity, and we derive using override and adding data and logic. And another idea is using object-oriented composition, where an entity is an aggregate of components. Components store data and logic, so the entity is like a dump container. And logic is handled still using runtime polymorphism, just using virtual functions. This is still easy to implement. It's way more flexible because we can compose using small classes. So for example, the text box is a composition of these small components. The problem is still cache unfriendly, and you still have the runtime overhead due to virtual dispatch. So here's how we solved the previous problem. Like, we are not limited to a hierarchy. We can just add the components like we desire, so it's much more flexible. In code, you will still have the virtual dispatch here, but we're doing it inside the component. And as you can see, the entity is just a container of components, And in this case, we still have a fixed interface, which is not nice. But we can have the flexibility by adding more components or removing components at runtime. And to create entities, what we actually do is create functions that will instantiate an entity, fill it with the components that we require, and then return the entity by value. Or in this case, we don't need to dynamically allocate the entity, but only the components. Now, what this talk is going to be about is a data-oriented design entity component system. It's best to think about this kind of design as a relational table, like in a database, where entities are just numerical IDs. Components do not store any kind of logic. They are just data. So you can think of them as plain old data structures. And logic is handled using systems. We'll take a look at the concept of a system very soon. But you have to know that in this way, we can contiguously store components of the same type. So we get the cache friendliness. And we don't have the runtime overhead caused by virtual dispatch. It's still as flexible as the previous version. The drawback is that it can be harder to implement. So here's the previous example. In this case, we can add components at runtime. And the systems will automatically figure out if an entity belongs to the system itself at runtime by doing some kind of matching. And by adding components, we actually match the entities to the systems. And the systems will perform logic over every entity that's inside the system. Is that clear to everyone? So you can think of the matching as a key and a socket. The system is the key. And if it fits inside the entity instance, then we say that the entity belongs to the system. So I implement this usually using bit sets. We can do an AND operation between bit sets, where every bit corresponds to a component type. The result of the bit sets operation needs to match the system signature. If this happens, then the entity belongs to the system. In code, this is a very naive implementation. An entity is just an ID. I use size T in this case. And I store components contiguously inside of arrays. Components are just pod structs, so there is no logic, no virtual dispatch. And it's very, very cache friendly in this way because every component is in a contiguous piece of memory. This is the system. What the system does is it usually has some kind of manager class or entity provider class. And you ask that class, can you give me all the entities that have the following components? And these components are usually gathered by the signature of the system. And you can do some logic and computation over all entities that match a specific component set. So this is the idea of a system. Also, systems can have data, like they can store data in their instances, and they can produce an output that can be consumed by other systems. Another problem is, how do we store components? So as you've seen in the previous slide, a very easy way of doing that is just using an array for every component type, and where the index is actually the ID of the entity. This is quite easy to implement, and it's suitable for most projects. The problem is that we obviously have some holes here if we don't have components for all the entities, and you can waste a lot of memory. Also, the holes may cause some cache misses because you don't have the components all together. A better solution, but very hard to implement, is using a system with indexing tables where you have a giant buffer. It could be fixed or resizable. And what you do is you have an indexing table for every component type. And when you add or remove components from entities, you have to modify those indexing tables in order to somehow compress and put the data in a convenient way. It's not easy to implement. What I chose for my library is, sure?
So what's the difference between this mega array approach and just heap allocating the components?
So the question is, what's the difference between the mega array approach and just heap allocating the components? I think that the mega array approach can be friendlier to the cache in case the components are small, since by doing some kind of clever compression and moving the components around in the mega array, you can still have like all the components for a specific entity one next to each other. So you have cache friendliness that way. While the heap allocation is always an indirection, and it's actually useful when the components are very big, you usually want heap allocation. So it's a trade-off between the size of the components and the cache friendliness. So I was saying that in my library, I allow the user to choose his favorite strategy. You just create a struct that satisfies a very simple interface, and you can create your own storage method, but we'll get into it later. So let's talk about the library itself. Is everything clear about the entity component system pattern? Okay. So the ideas behind the library is that it's a compile time entity component system. It's completely customizable, and it uses a policy-based design with a lot of settings that you can extend. It has a user-friendly syntax, which is independent from the settings. So if a system has multithreading support, or if it has to run sequentially, the syntax will be the same in terms of the logic. And it's obviously based on multithreading, as this is the scope of the talk. So, and I try to avoid explicit locking, and I try to follow the data flow programming style, where I try to define every step of the computations and the dependencies between the steps, and just let the system figure out how to run it. During the implementation and also in parts of the user code, I try to use type value encoding as much as possible, which is the idea behind Boost HANA, where types are stored in type values. So you're not going to see traditional metaprogramming, but I try to use that kind of method as it's more efficient and, in my opinion, easier to reason about. And obviously, I'm trying to strive for clean, modern, safe C++14. This is a single process framework. The parallelism and multithreading is inside a single process. So it's meant for like game development and real-time simulations, or as an example, GUI frameworks inside the same project, inside the same process. So what do I mean by compile time ECS? Component and system types are known at compile time. As you've seen, components are structs. Systems are structs as well that can have some data. And all of this has to be known at compile time. Component instances can be created or destroyed at runtime. So you can add and remove components from entities at runtime. Entities can be created, destroyed, and tracked at runtime. And you might think that it's not flexible, as you have to know all the types of the components and system at compile time. But in reality, you can combine it with an existing runtime entity component system and create a bridge component that bridges the two systems together. So it's used for performance, where you actually know the types of your components.
You didn't say whether system types are created at runtime.
So systems.
Or system instances, rather.
OK, the question is, are system instances created at runtime? The way I do it is I specify a compile-time list of system types. I create a context object, passing the list inside the context, and a single instance per system is created inside the context. So I don't think there is a need of instantiating a system manually. Just let the context do that for you. So the idea behind the benefits of the compile-time ECS is that it has minimal runtime overhead. It can allow the compiler to optimize it a little better. The problem is that we have longer compilation times and sometimes unwieldy error messages. This is an example of what I mean in practice. So components are just structs. Systems are structs as well. And what we do is we create signature objects, which are context objects, where we specify what the system is going to do. So in this case, the acceleration system is going to run in parallel after 10,000 entities. And the parallelism is going to be split evenly in all the cores. The system does not depend on any other system. It's going to mutate the velocity component, and it's going to read the acceleration component. And it's not going to produce any output. So what we do is create a list of these signatures. We pass it to a context, and the context deals with memory allocation for us and provides us a very nice interface to interact with the system. So I talked about errors. This is a G++ error. I slightly misspelled a field in a component, and G++ 5.3 just overflow my terminal's buffer, and it is impossible to understand what's going on. Clang++ is much nicer in this aspect, because even if the error is very long, it actually pinpoints like the exact position of the mistake at the beginning of the error, so you can see that. Well, this is nice. The problem is when the code compiles on Clang, but it doesn't compile on G++, because then you have to like pipe the output inside a file and use some regexes or search to understand what's going on. Yeah, I tried with G++ 6 as well, and it's more towards the Clang side, so you can actually pinpoint the error with G++ 6, so there have been some improvements in that aspect. I will try using ideas from the dependency injection talk that was yesterday, like hiding the error and erasing the type name, as I think that will improve both compilation time and debugging errors. One strange thing is that while Clang produces better errors, G++ actually compiled twice as fast, which is strange. It's usually the other way around, but that has been my experience. So this is what I mean by customizable settings and poly-based design. Behavior and storage layouts for entities and components can be chosen at compile time, and the users of the library can create their own strategies and containers. So if you want to implement a NashMap container for a component, you just create a template class that takes the type of the component. And what you do is just define some simple interface functions such as get and add that take some arguments. The arguments are usually the entity ID and any container-specific metadata. As you can have like a struct metadata here that will be instantiated in every entity so that you can implement the indexing table, mega array structure, or you can be clever with your containers by adding more data that the entities can use. The syntax is independent from the settings you choose. So if the acceleration system runs in parallel or it runs sequentially, it doesn't matter. It's all hidden behind this kind of nice interface where you ask the data, which is some kind of proxy object, give me all the entities that belong to this system and do something on them. And as you can see, you can get components, but you don't know what the component storage is. You can get entities, but you don't know what entities you're acting on. So it's all abstracted away. When you're executing systems, what you want to usually do is create an overload here. And the system is going to figure out what you're going to execute. And the process function is not hard-coded, it's not a special function. You just define these overloads and pass data to the systems. So you just list every system type in your overload, and during runtime, it's going to call the correct overload based on the dependencies. This is how I think about multithreading. I have two levels of parallelism. An outer level, that means that the independent system can run in parallel in independent chains, and an inner parallelism that can split all the entities inside of a system in smaller subsets and execute the logic of the system in parallel over those entities. So this is a simple animation. Maybe we're running the first system. As soon as we are done, we run both of them in parallel. The first system supports like the subtask splitting, and it gets divided in smaller tasks. And as soon as every smaller task is done, then we can run the final system. Type value encoding, as I mentioned earlier, is the technique used in HANA and other modern metaprogramming libraries, where every value is actually wrapping a unique type. Think about integral constant, for example. And it greatly simplifies metaprogramming and compile-time computations. So the setting structure that you see on the right is actually a context value that you are creating by passing other values to functions. And all the data is stored inside the type of the object so that we can make use of it at compile time. As you can see, we pass this settings value by value to the context function. And the context function is actually going to query the value at compile time. Another example of the power of type value encoding is when dealing with list computations compile time. So in this case, I have a tag list of systems, and I want to create an ID list from the tag list. And I can actually use a lambda inside a compile time computation. As you can see, it's constexpr, and I'm returning a transform list using a lambda. So it's very natural. It's normal C++ syntax, but you're doing things at compile time. So I'm now going to show you a code example, a small demo of a particle simulation. It's nothing spectacular. It's just to show you how the system can work in practice. So hopefully I'll be able to duplicate my display here. Okay. Oops, I have to duplicate. Okay, so you're looking at 20,000 particles that are colliding with each other, and everything runs in parallel. It's not very fast on the surface, but on my normal computer, it goes quite fast. And by increasing the number of particles and keeping the multithreading enabled, you can see a lot of benefits. I don't have precise benchmarks yet, but just to give you some kind of idea, by increasing the number of particles to 200,000, I get a 3-pair speed up by enabling multithreading, and I lose that speed up by disabling multithreading.
How many cores?
Four? On my home computer, it's 8 cores. Yeah. Okay, 8 cores. So I'm just going to open the code file, and I'm going to give you a quick look how this is implemented. Hopefully, I'll be able to do it. Okay. So the idea is that every particle will have the following components: a position component, velocity, acceleration, color, and circle. And this is probably not the best way of implementing it. It's just a toy. I'd rather have the position, velocity, and acceleration the same component if I were doing something real. And we'll have the following systems in the simulation: an acceleration system that will just accelerate, a velocity system that will just move. And as you can see, I'm specifying the dependencies, and if I allow the systems to be executed in parallel inside. So if I want the system to be split into multiple subtasks. Then I will have a keeping bounds system that will prevent the particles from leaving the simulation boundaries. A spatial partitioning system that is actually a 2D grid to speed up broad-based collision detection. And this spatial partitioning system will produce a list of pairs of entity IDs and cell IDs, which will be later consumed by the filler system, which will fill the data structure without enabling parallelism, so that we don't have to use a mutex or any kind of synchronization. We will have a collision system that will produce a list of contacts, and a system that will solve the contacts sequentially. So as you can see, this is very powerful in a certain way, because you can produce data in parallel and then have another system consume the data sequentially to avoid any kind of synchronization in data structures. And then we'll have a system for rendering. So here I just defined some constants for the boundaries and my contact and spatial partitioning data structures. So a contact is just a pair of entity IDs and the distance between the entities to resolve the contact. The spatial partitioning system is just the spatial partitioning data is just the ID of the entity and the cell where the entity has to be inserted. Then I define my components, which are just plain old data structures.
Okay, sorry, is the contact thing, is that equal to the sum of the sizes of the circles?
So the question is the contact struct equal to the sum of the radius you said? The contact system is actually the distance field inside the contact is actually the penetration between the circles, so that I can resolve the penetration by moving every circle. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
It's not very clear. Sorry. So there is a very annoying thing we're dealing with heavily templated code, that sometimes you have to specify this dot template here to pass a type to a method, which is extremely annoying. So what I decided to do is to create some constex empty tag objects that you can pass as values. And those will be just used to avoid that syntax. So you can think of the tag CT position tag just as an empty size wrapper for the C position type. Sure.
There's another common solution to this problem. I don't know if you can make a non-member version of the function, and then that also is just
okay. So the comment is that you could make a non-member function, so you don't have to use template. And if you remember my slides, I actually had an ACST dot dot get, which was non-member. But to be honest, I think that this syntax is easier to use because you don't have to specify the namespace, and it gets annoying later. So this way you avoid specifying the namespace over and over.
You probably don't have to specify the namespace if the type of data is in the same namespace as the get function.
Okay, the comment is that you probably don't have to specify the namespace if the type of data is in the same namespace. So the type of data is a proxy which is in the library namespace, but the system itself is not in the library namespace. I'm not sure if that, I think you still have to specify the namespace. I'm not sure about that. So I'm using a macro here to define the tags, but the macro is just a simple expansion that prevents the repetition of the name of the component. So it's just a context value. It's very simple. And I'm doing this both for the components and the systems. Now I'll define the systems. So the first system I'm going to define is the acceleration system. And what I'm going to do is define a process method here that will take a frame time value, which is a float, is the delta time value, and the data proxy. And the data proxy is generated by the framework and will allow you to do an action over a set of entities. So the process method, as I specified earlier, is not hard-coded in any way. You can create any method you want. The way it works is later in the execution step, you pass a lambda to the system, and you specify the method that you want to be executed inside that system. So it's very flexible. This piece of code here for entities abstracts away the idea of having a subset of entities per subtask, so it can work with every entity or with a subtask of entities. As you can see here, to get components, we just use data.get with the tag of the component. And we have to be careful about the reference that we're using, if it's const or non-const, as that will be statically asserted, because we are specifying in the system signatures if we're going to only mutate or only read from a component. So that's another benefit of having compile time knowledge.
I see
V is velocity.
Yeah, and then it gets... Oh, sorry, I got it. All right.
OK.
I didn't see the ampersand.
So we do the same for the velocity system. In the keep inbound system, we just do some calculations to get the left, right, top, and bottom coordinates of a particle and just keep in the bounds. It's very simple. So the spatial partitioning system is more interesting because, as I said earlier, we have an instance of every system type stored inside the context. So in this case, we're going to have some data inside the system. In this case, it's just a 2D grid to speed up collisions. And we can have any kind of method we want inside the system. Another cool thing about the spatial partitioning system is that it will produce an output. So in this case, the output is a vector of contacts. And I'll show you later how we can specify what output we want system to produce. So we can just get a reference to the output vector and clear it before we start the processing for every entity. And we do some calculation here. And for every cell in which the entity is supposed to be, we add the spatial partition data instance to the output vector. An important thing is that every subtask, when we are splitting the system in multiple threads, has its own output vector. So it's not a single structure that's locked between threads. Every subtask has its own vector. And the idea is that in a subsequent system, such as the spatial filler here, we're going to ask the data proxy to give us all the previous outputs of spatial partitions. We don't know how those outputs are taken, if it was just a single task or multiple tasks, is abstracted away. And for those outputs, we're going to perform something. Also, this method here that gets the previous outputs, static always checks if the system is actually if it's actually possible to get the outputs in terms of dependencies between systems. So the other systems do pretty much the same thing. Some check the collisions. And this produces the contact list. If the
Can sure. you show the collision?
Sure. Yeah. OK.
Because this does probably need two entities at the same time.
Sure, yeah. OK. Good point. So the comment was that I better not skip the collision because it's actually an interesting system as it has to loop over two entities at the same time. So here we have an output vector of contacts, which is the previous structure that you've seen. we get a reference to the previous system, which is partial partition system. And we can do this because we specified a compile time that collision comes after special partition. Otherwise, it wouldn't compile. And we're iterating over every entity in the subtask. And we have this helper function here called for unique pairs. And what this does is iterate over every other entity ID inside the system. And it discards pairs that are not unique by comparing the IDs of the particle. So it's just less or if the first ID is less or equal to the second one, just skip it. And we get we're accessing the second particle's component data using the same data proxy. We check for the distance between the centers and the radius to find out if there is a collision. And if a collision actually happens, we emplace a contact in the output vector. So to clarify a little bit this two-ID iteration, this four entities here loops over only a subset of the particles if the system is running in parallel, while this other lambda here loops over every particle inside the system. Okay. So we have the solved contact system.
Another
sure.
Question. In the four unique pairs.
Yes.
You pass this cell to four unique pairs.
Yeah.
What does that do?
We need the cell because we want to get the only the ID, the IDs that belong to the system that are in this cell that we used previously.
Is something that is understood by an ECS type.
No, no. For unique pairs is just a utility function for the demo.
Oh. Okay.
Inside the function, we iterate over every ID of the cell, mm-hmm. and it's just to speed up the protocol collisions. If you wanted to do it without the utility function, you'd just say data for entities again, yeah. and do the thing manually. The next system takes all the outputs of the collision system here. And for every output, it does some calculations and it solves the penetration between particles. Then we have the rendering system, which doesn't actually render. It produces vectors of vertices. I'm using the SFML library just to be quick in development. And I'm producing vector of vertices by doing some calculation. Here I'm creating the circles by triangles. And afterwards, in a later step, I just draw all the vectors sequentially to the window. Now we need to set up our compile time settings. So this is an example of the type value encoding I'm talking about. This is a variable, a context variable, that's initialized through a templatized size t value. But the value is actually stored inside the variable itself. So you can pass it as a value, but its real number can be taken at compile time. So it's a compile time value. So we can have an entity limit, an initial particle count. Now we need to make a component signature list and a system signature list that we need to give to the context. The component signature list is just a list of every component type. While the system signature list is a little more complex, as we have to specify what a system can do and cannot do. So as you can see here, every signature of a system is a context variable where we specify the type of the system, whether or not it can be parallel, if the system has any dependency, and what components it is going to use, and finally, it can have an output. So in the case of the acceleration system, we're using the parallelism strategy, which is defined up there, which just splits the system execution evenly between every core. We don't have any dependency, so the framework will understand that this is the first system to execute to start off the chain. And we're just telling the framework what components we're going to use in order to improve the compile time safety, as we're going to get compiler time errors if we don't satisfy those restrictions. So we create every signature for our systems. The important thing is like we have to think about what system can run in parallel and what system cannot run in parallel. Because if we have a data structure that's not synchronized between threads, we have to think about the trade-off of adding an explicit locking mechanism or making their system run in parallel. So this is the interesting thing. And if the system produces an output, we just specify the type of the output in the signature, and we can get the instance of the output of every subtask inside the system by using the data proxy that I've shown earlier. Is everything clear so far?
Right.
Sure.
Component use, can you tell me about what that is again?
So this is a function that returns a compile time value that tells the framework what components the system is going to use. So here we're saying that the special partition system
produces a tag.
Yeah, it's a sort of tag. We're just telling that the special partition system reads position and reads circle and does nothing else with components. So after we specify all the systems, we just make a list of those, and we can return it. And we'll later use this function that builds the lists to create the final settings and pass the settings to the context so that we can actually instantiate it. To create entities, we use functions. In this case, the function makeParticle takes a proxy, which is something similar to the data proxy for the systems. And we can ask the proxy to create an entity for us, and this will eventually allocate space if it's required, and it will give us an ID that we can use. And we can attach components to that ID, and we immediately get access to the memory of the components so that we can mutate the memory. Obviously, this is not something that we can do during execution of a system. And to solve this issue, we actually defer the operation after the execution of the systems. But I'll talk about this a little later. So we can init the context by using the step method that will return a proxy. This is not a data proxy. This is a step proxy. And the step proxy allows us to call those mutating functions that can can allocate memory and that may require synchronization. So this is where we create the initial particle count. Then to update our simulation, what we do is we create a function here, a helper function, that will take the context by reference, some render target, which is an SFML window, and the delta time to make the simulation work independently from the frame time. We, again, invoke the step function, which will give us a step proxy. And the step proxy is more powerful than the system proxy, as we can use those operations that can allocate and can create entities and so forth. And the first thing we do in our update step is get the system from the proxy and clear all the cells of the special partition. Then this is how I decide to execute systems. I just create an overload of lambdas by passing any number of lambdas to this variadic function here that will build an overload set. And when the system is executed, it will pass the current system to this lambda, which will trigger overload resolution. And that's the way we can tell the framework how we want our system to be executed. Sure.
Can I run a subset of the systems at this point?
That's a very good question. Can you run a subset of the systems at this point? Not in this branch, but in the branch I have on GitHub, yes. I'm trying to generalize the execution. And you will actually be able to not only specify how you want entities to be processed, but also have a beginning and a end step per system.
All of those are very similar. I'm wondering if there's a reason that you didn't make it so the process had the same signature for everything and just have a single lambda.
Okay, so the question is, most of them are very similar. I wonder why you didn't use some kind of a lambda that grouped the systems together.
Just make process have the same signature for everything so there's only a single.
Or just have process have the same signature. So they are similar, but they are not equal, because as you can see, process here takes the delta time, which is required for the simulation calculations. But here we don't need the delta time, so why should I pass it? That's my reasoning. I could have process have the same signature, but then I wouldn't use delta time inside the system.
Yeah, so you just ignore it.
Ignore it, yeah.
That's how I would do it.
I don't like it. And after we execute the systems, so just to be clear, the whole overload here blocks until all the systems are executed. After all the systems are executed, we can do additional things. In this case, we ask the proxy to give us all the outputs of the render system, which, if you remember, were vectors of vertices. And we just draw the vectors on our window.
It blocks a spatial filler? Or
no, no.
Some of these are not parallel, right?
Yeah. The higher level like overview is that this whole thing blocks the execution of the context.
Okay.
So when you call this overload, you are blocking here.
Yeah.
And all of this is just executing in parallel or in sequentially, but it's separate. So the system execution step, it's separate. But it blocks when you start executing the systems until all systems are done.
Okay.
And that's pretty much it. The last thing we have to do is define the settings for the context. So we can disable or enable parallelism at a global level. We can tell the context that we're going to have a fixed entity limit or a dynamic entity limit. And we can use that for some smaller optimizations. And we have to pass the list of component types and the list of system signatures and some kind of scheduler that we'll use to schedule system execution. In this case, I have only a single scheduler implemented, which uses an atomic counter to wait for all dependencies to be done and move on to the next system. Then we can create a context and run the simulation. And that's it. Any question about the demo?
Very impressive.
Thank you.
So can you show me where it's like, I mean, that ultimately this is like executing some number of time steps? Where does
the game
to be finished?
Where's the game loop?
The game, okay. Is that a question? Like, where is the loop that executes? Okay. So the question is, where is the game loop, basically? And if you see here, the update context function is just a frame of the game. And I called that repeatedly somewhere.
Okay.
I don't remember where.
So when you say finished, you're saying finished one frame.
Yeah, just one frame. Okay, inside the run simulation, I have some boilerplate code that asks the window for events, like keyboard events and that stuff, runs a frame and then calculates the delta time and runs another frame until I press the S key. So it's inside here, it's hidden. But the idea is just a regular game loop. So let's go back to the slides. And if I have time, hopefully, what's the time?
It's 5:15.
Okay. I'm gonna show you something about the architecture. So how many minutes do we have left? OK, I have time. So by architecture, it's not working, sorry. OK, by architecture, I mean like how I structure the system and what the elements of the frameworks are. The context is an aggregate of these three elements, the main storage, the system manager, and the refresh state, and it's movable. And in code, it corresponds to that kind of instantiation. What you do is that you pass the settings to the context as a template parameter. Here is a value that gets then evaluated as a template parameter. And that parameter is propagated inside the elements of the context. The main storage deals with entity storage, which deals with entity IDs and metadata. And it also has the component storage, which deals with component data and component storage strategies. The entity storage itself keeps track of used and unused entity IDs in order to reuse them and recycle them, and keeps track of the entity metadata. So the metadata for an entity is the combination of a bit set, which specifies what components the entity has in a specific moment, and a counter that is used to instantiate handles and be sure that the same handle refers to the previous entity. Because if the ID is recycled and we have an handle pointing to a specific ID, we use the counter to make sure that even if the ID is recycled, the handle we recognize that it's not the same entity as before. So this is where the tracking specific entities idea comes into play, by having these handle classes that check if the counter is equal. But we can also have additional component storage metadata. I said this earlier, but this class here is templated over a tuple of metadata that is constructed by every component storage strategy. So if a component storage requires the entity to store some kind of data that is used to retrieve the component data, it will be stored inside this metadata at compile time. The component storage is a tuple of chunks, and every chunk deals with the storage of a specific component type, and that's it. The chunk is usually we have some data, which is a data structure, and it has to satisfy the get interface that gives a reference to the component given an entity ID. The system manager was another element inside the context, and it is composed by a thread pool, a system runner, and a system storage. The system runner is just an interface for the scheduler, which will use the thread pool to run the threads. And the system storage just stores every system instance one time inside the context so that you can access the fields of the system. And this is the implementation is just a tuple of instances of every single system type. So instance wraps the user-defined system type and adds some extra stuff to it to deal with output and multithreading, parallelism, that stuff. And the instance has the data, which is the user-defined system type, a state manager that manages the subtasks, the split during the parallelism, and assigns a state to every subtask so that every thread can have its own output. It has a sparse set of subscribed entities, which is, you can think about it as a list of IDs of entities that are subscribed to the system. An executor that is an instance that deals with inner parallelism and can be stateful. And a bit set that represents the required components in order for an entity to be subscribed to the system. And this is where we do the end between the bit sets of the system and the entity.
That was your key and your log.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
The state manager is an array of states. Every state has a correspondence with a subtask, and a subtask is a piece of execution that is executed in a separate thread. The state has a set of IDs that have to be killed in the next refresh step. So if we are dealing, I don't know, with collision between particles and we want to destroy one of the particles in parallel, every subtask would have a list of those IDs, and then in a separate step, we iterate sequentially over those lists and deal with the deallocation of the entities. And we also have a list of deferred functions, and those are the functions that can be used to create entities, allocate memory, and do critical operations that would require synchronization. And we defer those operations to a later step, which will be executed sequentially. Optionally, every state also has an instance of the output data type. So now I'm going to show you some code, finally, some implementation code. And I'll start by giving you a brief overview of what we're going to see. We're going to see how the execution flow is implemented and what critical operations are, some challenges that I encountered during implementation, how system processing works. We're going to details in the multithreading system, how proxy works and what they are, and some small examples of the metaprogramming inside the library. So the execution flow, you can think about it in a three-step execution flow where we have a begin step where we execute some user code and some critical operations which can create components, entities, and allocate memory. Then we step into the system execution where all that stuff takes place in parallel, sequentially. So we block until the system execution is done. After we have finished processing every single system, we have the refresh step, which will execute the deferred functions that the system produced. We'll reclaim the dead entity IDs so that they can be reused in the next execution step. And it will match entities to the systems again. Because during executions, some components may have been removed from entities, and some components may have been added to entities. So we need to make sure that everything is matched again. And that's it. We'll get to this later. We're actually going to analyze every single step in detail. What is a critical operation? So I define critical operations as operations that have to be executed sequentially in a final separate step, because otherwise we would have to use a mutex or some kind of synchronization, which could be expensive. A critical operation could be the creation of or destruction of an entity. And this is annoying because we may have to allocate memory while creating the entity, or we may have to recycle an ID while destroying the entity, and that could be used by another system later in the execution step. Also, adding and removing a component is critical because other systems in the execution chain may want that component, which we just removed. And running the system scheduler is obviously critical. We cannot run another system scheduler inside a system. So this is a way of separating what you can do inside a system and outside of a system. If you want to do something critical inside of a system, like creating an entity, you have to defer it to a later step by just using a lambda, which in turn it creates an std function that will later be executed to have the result of the critical operation. Non-critical operations can be done inside system processing. You can analyze system output data inside a system, as we have just seen in the demo. You can mark an entity as dead because it's just an ID that will be later processed to reclaim the memory and reuse the ID. And you can access and mutate existing component data. So if you want to create a lot of entities, like inside of a system, maybe you have a particle spawner system, it's best to batch those operations inside a single defer call, as you're going to create some kind of object that will have to be passed to a later step. So there is some overhead there. Try to minimize deferred functions and try to batch them together where possible. So this is an example of collision effects. This is non-critical, as we can query the previous system. This is non-critical, as we're just getting a reference to an existing component for an entity. This is also non-critical. Let's assume here that every entity has an health component. And if the health reaches zero, we want to kill the entity. We are not actually deallocating the memory here. We're just saying, this is an ID I want to be reclaimed in the future. So we're just marking the ID. So this is non-critical. But if you actually want to create an entity and add a component to it and maybe do some important operation on that memory, you have to defer it to a later step. So the syntax here allows you to call data.defer and pass a function to it that will be stored in the state of the subtask. And later, when you are done with the system execution, every state will be iterated sequentially and every defer function will be executed. So there is some overhead here because this actually creates a std function. There probably is a better alternative, maybe fixed functions with a small buffer or some kind of command class that you can inherit from, which could be more efficient, but it's not a problem right now. Okay. The execution flow in the user code looks like this, as you've seen in the demo. The first step here is where we execute system user code. Then we have this execute system overload step, and then we can do other stuff at the end. So the important thing is that the step call will give us a step proxy that allows us to immediately execute deferred operations, critical operations, and will also allow us to execute the system. All of this is user code. You can do whatever you want there. This is the system execution step. And the important thing is that at the end of the lambda, a refresh will be triggered, which will analyze what the system have done. It will execute the first steps, and it will allocate and deallocate memory for the entities. So it's kind of Ray in disguise. We just execute those things inside the lambda. And as soon as we reach the end of the lambda, the system automatically executes a refresh, which deals with the critical operations. We'll check the code for the flow, the implementation code for the flow later. We'll talk about some challenges first. And the challenges were the efficient management of entity IDs and using compile time knowledge to increase performance and safety, executing system respecting dependencies and using parallelism when possible, processing entity subsets of the same system in different threads, and dealing with critical operations while providing a safe and clean interface to the user. So, entity IDs, we need to be very efficient when dealing with those, because we need to check if an ID is part of a system. We need to add and remove IDs from systems, and we need to iterate over every ID inside of a system. Turns out there is a very, very nice data structure which is called sparse integer set. And this data structure is just a pair of vectors. One is a dense vector, and one is a sparse vector. The dense vector will contain all the IDs in an unordered way so that you can iterate over them in an O n complexity, where n is the number of set IDs inside of the structure. And it also contains a sparse vector, which will allow you to check whether or not an ID is part of the set in O one. So it's a very powerful, very powerful data structure, and it's used for the management of entity IDs throughout the whole framework. As you can see, the complexity for checking if an ID is in there, for adding an ID, or for erasing an ID is all constant, and the iteration of overall IDs is linear in the number of IDs that are inside the set.
Taking advantage of not needing to initialize your sparse vector.
So the question is, are you taking advantage of not needing to initialize your sparse vector? I don't think you cannot. You have to initialize it because you need some kind of special value that represents an invalid ID.
It's more than size is not initialized. Any value that is less than size is pointing to a real thing.
Yeah, that's a good idea. But
it's undefined behavior.
How can you be sure that the others are outside the size range? I think you still have to initialize it.
It's something.
Sure. We can talk about it later. The drawbacks are that you don't have efficient bit set like operations. You cannot do an AND efficiently between sparse integer sets. And obviously, that you use a lot more memory than an STD bit set. OK. Any questions?
If it points into the dent to the left side of the dense part, if that value doesn't match the index of this in the sparse one, then that's an invalid entry.
Yes, but you still are not sure that the uninitialized values do that. Maybe they would point to something that is actually inside the set. We can talk about it. Maybe there is a solution, I don't know. So I'm using compile time knowledge to dispatch data structures to compile time, because maybe the user has a limit on the entities. So maybe we have a fixed limit of 20,000 entities. Or maybe our game or our project requires us to have a dynamic set of entities. And I'm using these type value encoding functions that use static if, which I will talk about tomorrow if you're interested in its implementation. And I'm wrapping types inside these type V tags, basically. And depending on the settings of my context, I can have these small optimizations. Because if I know that I have a fixed set of entities, I will avoid checking for eventual reallocations and growing the buffer. That will never happen. We assume that will not happen because the user told us so. So these are small optimizations that we can implement thanks to the compile time knowledge of the settings. Another example is in the entity storage. Maybe we can have a fixed entity storage or a dynamic entity storage. And in the case of a fixed one, we don't have to grow or have additional locations. In case of a dynamic one, we have branches and reallocation, which can be detrimental to the performance. System settings and dependencies. So this is critical to the functionality of the framework, because we need to know at compile time the dependencies between systems to build that implicit graph that will allow us to schedule system execution in parallel. And we do that by using these kind of tags, for example, depends on. We also need to specify what components we're going to use. And this is currently just to give the user some errors in case they are not using const where they should be using const. But this knowledge could be used to make sure that systems that are being executed in parallel do not have data races. I still didn't implement that, but it could be used to make the system a lot safer. Also, we can specify a parallelism strategy. Maybe some systems have big components, and we want to use a small amount of cores for those. Maybe a system requires to be executed sequentially. So we can specify those strategies here. What we end up with is an implicit directed acyclic graph that looks a little like this. And all the information, the compile time information, is stored in the type of the system themselves. So we can use it to optimize the system and deal with dependencies. So yeah, this is statically asserted thanks to the compile time information. Let's get to the multithreading. So it's a very, very simple implementation. I have a thread pool with a lock-free queue and a number of workers. I don't use any STD future or something or stuff like that, as it's too expensive. I tried it in a previous implementation. I was actually using packages, tasks, and futures, but it is a lot of overhead. It was much slower unless I had enormous number of entities that could run in multiple cores. So what I do is a very simple thing. I have this lock-free queue that I found on GitHub. It's by Cameron, this Rogers. Sorry if the name's not pronounced correctly. And this queue is concurrent, lock-free, and blocking. So my thread pool implementation is extremely obvious and simple. Every worker has a task buffer. It waits for the queue to give him the task. It executes the tasks while the worker is running. That's pretty much it. Sure.
How difficult would it be to modify your system that the user can plug in its own thread pool? What if I want to use Intel TBB for?
OK, the question is, how do you think the system would change if we allow the user to use its own thread pool? I didn't think about it. This is a good question. There is not a lot of coupling between the system execution stuff and the thread pool. It's just like an executing thread pool function that takes a callable object. So I don't think it would be like too difficult to implement some kind of policy that will allow the user to pass its own thread pool. That's a good idea. But I think that this is as simple and efficient as it can get. It's just a queue and a number of workers. Synchronization, as I said, is not done through futures. I use condition variables and atomic counters, both for the outer and the inner parallelism. And I created a counter blocker struct, which is an aggregation of a mutex, a condition variable, and an atomic counter. And I have this nice abstraction here that's called execute and wait until counter is zero, where I create a counter blocker, and I initialize it with an initial counter value. And I ask the system, run the tasks and block until the counter reaches zero. And this is using condition variables to avoid busy waiting, so it doesn't stress the CPU. This is what it looks like. It's just a struct, which has a condition variable, a mutex, and a counter. And the counter is initialized through the constructor. And we have some functions that take these elements to make it very easy to synchronize stuff. So for example, to access the counter inside the counter blocker, we have this function here, which requires a callable object that will be called as soon as we get the lock on the mutex. So we can prevent any kind of mistake in the implementation this way. When F is called, we are sure that we have access to the counter, to the condition variable, and to the counter. And we use that function in the decrement function. And what we do is we pass our mutex, our condition variable, and our counter. And as soon as we get a lock on the mutex, the continuation function will be called. And we can do some assertions there. We can decrement the counter, and we can notify the threads waiting on the counter in a clean way. And there is no chance of making a mistake like this, because the continuation functions make sure that we are not using those variables in parts of the code where we do not have the lock. We don't have ownership of the lock. The things that wraps everything is the execute and wait until function that takes a predicate and a callable object And what it does is it takes the ownership of the mutex, it calls the functions that we passed, and we wait until the predicate is true. So we are assuming that the passed f callable object will start the execution of the systems, and every system will decrement the counter, and eventually, after calling f, the predicate will become true, and the condition variable will stop blocking the main execution thread. Those functions have a nicer version that takes the counter blocker as a reference. So in the end, the implementation code becomes really easy to read, easy to maintain, it's very simple. I explore a different alternative with a when all and then chain generation, which are the boost future, I don't know how to call them. They are the functions that can help you schedule functions based on the result of other functions and stuff like that. It's basically monadic continuation for futures. And it is very hard to implement correctly because you have to generate the chain at compile time depending on on all the data you get from the systems or from the signatures. And it's also extremely inefficient because you have a lot of overhead because every future has every package's task has a future and some virtual overhead, some virtual dispatching. So it sounded interesting in my mind until I tried it, and the easier solution with the atomic counter is actually more efficient and easier to implement. So the scheduler uses a counter blocker to start the system execution, where n is the number of systems. It fires off the system execution and waits until every system is completed, and every system thread will decrement the counter by one. And every system instance, if parallelism is enabled for that system, will start execution of every subtask using another counter blocker and a remaining dependency counter to make sure that systems which depend on each other do not have race conditions. We have a remaining dependencies atomic counter per system, which is a separate counter from the previous one. And in the beginning, all instances with zero dependencies are executed by the scheduler. And as soon as an instance is done, all dependence counters are decremented. And if one of those counters becomes zero, we can execute the system safely. So it's a very easy way of implementing generic direct acyclic graph execution for tasks.
And if none of them become one, then you decrement them again.
Can you make an example? It shouldn't happen. Like, everything works correctly.
Right. Okay.
So let's see some code. The scheduler here is what starts fire off the execution of every system. The counter blocker here is initialized with the count of systems. We start the execution and wait until the counter is zero. So we are blocking there. The number of systems is actually the count of types inside the system signature list. So if we add 5 system signatures, this will be initialized to 5. And here we start execution. The execution of every single task, where a task is the processing of a system, consists in the execute function that will call the overload function over the system, which will execute all the processing. As soon as that function is done, we'll decrement the counter of systems. We will loop over every dependent system. And if that system has no more dependencies left, we will execute it in the thread pool. And this can answer your question. This is basically how thread pool works here. We just pass a function to it. So it's very easy to add another thread pool. So this line of code here prevents the execution of a system if more dependencies are left. Think of a fork join situation. When we are at the join, the system that's being joined on will be called 2 times by 2 separate systems, and it will be only executed 1 time, as will return first, because we are decrementing the dependency counter. This F here is the execute system overload function. So we're taking it from the step user code and passing it through every single step inside the scheduler. And since the system instance will have its own unique type, it will get the correct overload there and do the right thing. Inner parallelism of a system is implemented using a counter blocker as well. A system instance has a counter of running subtasks, as soon as a subtask is finished, we decrement the counter. And when the counter reaches zero, we stop blocking for the system, and we can move forward with the scheduling. A cool thing about splitting strategies is that they can be composed at compile time. I inspired myself from the Alexandrescu talk about allocators, where you can compose allocators at compile time, and you can compose the splitting strategies in the same way. So you could have like run sequentially if there are less than X entities, then run in parallel on N cores and just compose your strategies like that. And the executors can be stateful. A motivating example may be a self-profiling executor that profiles itself during runtime execution and maybe understands where it's beneficial to be single-threaded or multi-threaded depending on the count of entities. So this is parallel execution. It's very difficult, as you can see. We just call the executor passing the system instance, the context, and the function, which is the previously seen overload set. And we handle synchronization inside the executor. This is an example of an executor, which the user can implement its own executors, but this is only an example where we split the entire entity set evenly into smaller subsets. So we have a number of subtasks, and we calculate how many entities we want to give every subtask. Now we have this prepare and wait function that will clear and prepare n states inside the system instance. It will initialize a counter blocker for every subtask, and it will block until every subtask is done using that counter blocker abstraction. And that function f there is this lambda here that we're passing to the prepare and wait function. And this lambda will take care of splitting the entities into separate ranges and executing the user function on those separate entities in multiple threads. So imagine that the split count is 4. This ramp subtask will create 4 separate execution functions. And they will be executed in parallel. And as soon as they are done, we stop blocking and we keep on executing the other systems. So how do we actually slice the entities' ranges? We create a stateful lambda that captures the begin index and end index of the sparse set. And we do that for every single subtask. And we move around these lambdas in the system execution. And as you can see, we are taking the indices by value. So we're copying them and storing them inside the lambda. And this is where we bind the range of entities that has to be processed in a separate thread. The slice executor will ask the system to give to produce some kind of object that we can iterate upon, which will return us the subset of entities we desire. And as soon as we execute that, we will decrement the counter and keep on going with the other subtasks. This data you see here is the data that we used in the demo to query for components. And to do, this is the data proxy. And when we call four entities of the data proxy, we're calling four entities on this data object. And since we have the ranges here, that four entities is just going to iterate over a small subset of the system entities. The execute subtask and decrement counter function just calls f, which is the overload set, which in turn calls the process function with the system instance and the data proxy. And then it will decrement the counter and notify all the system that's waiting on that, on the subtask execution. So what are proxies? Proxies are just simple classes that are used to limit the scope in which critical operation can be executed. Data proxies are used during system execution, while deferred proxies are used to defer critical operation to a later step. The way that they are implemented in I used a lot of templates, and I passed the lambdas to the proxies. I moved the lambdas into the proxies, and then I provide an interface with a name to call those lambdas. So it's there's very little hard-coded behavior, and data proxies can implement that for entity stuff depending on the parallel execution strategy. So it's not bound to anything. It's very, very dynamic and flexible. So this is the data proxy. The deferred proxy is the proxy that you get when you call defer on the data proxy, which allows you to make critical operations. And the step proxy is given by the context. And it derives from the defer proxy. So you can do whatever you want, whatever you could do with the defer proxy. In addition, you can also start system execution. So let's get back to the implementation overview of the execution flow. As you can see, this is the begin step. This is the system execution. We are missing the refresh step. And you can see a sneak peek here. The begin step in the implementation code is very simple. We have a refresh state. The refresh state just keeps track of all the entities we have to match and all the entities we have to reclaim. So it's a single object that will be filled by the execution of the systems. And after it is filled, we will rematch and reclaim the entities during the refresh step. So we create a proxy, a step proxy, and we execute the function that the user provided, passing the proxy as one of the parameters. The refresh step is divided in three sub-steps. We have a step to execute all the deferred functions. We have a step to kill all the entities and reclaim their IDs. And we have a step to rematch all the entities with the systems. The execution step is very simple. We create a defer proxy. We iterate over the system sequentially, so no parallelism here. And for every state inside the system, we execute the defer functions by passing the proxy that we just created. This execution here fills the refresh state, which is taken by reference, and it should be captured in the lambda. Sorry, that's a mistake in the slide. And while we fill the refresh state, in the next step, we will actually read from the refresh state to reclaim entities. So here, we first iterate over system sequentially and over every state to get those marked entities into the global refresh state, which has a single set of entities to kill.
Remind me again, the systems are like the acceleration system, velocity system.
Yes. Yeah. So every system has, as you remember, some subtasks. Every subtask has a state. And inside that state, you can mark some entities as dead. What we're doing here is just accumulating all those data, all those states into a single set of IDs. Then we can run the other systems in parallel. And we can unsubscribe those entities from the systems in parallel, because we're just iterating over the set. And at the end of the reclaim step, we just need to tell the entity storage that that ID can be reused in the future. And what will happen is that that ID will get back into the free ID set, and we will increment the handle counter to prevent tracking of dead entities. The last step is rematching entities to system, because during the execution of the deferred functions, we might have added a component to an entity or created a new entity altogether. So we iterate over the systems in parallel. And that refresh state there has been filled in the previous steps by creating entities or adding removing components. And for every system in parallel, we just do the bitset trick here. We do the end between the bitsets and check if it's equal to the system bitsets. And if it matches, we subscribe it. If it doesn't match, we unsubscribe it. And thanks to the sparse set structure, this is in constant time. So it's very, very quick. So we're almost done. I just wanted to give you some examples of metaprogramming. So as I said, I use type value encoding, which means that I tend to write modern metaprogramming in the style of Boost HANA. And I have a heavy usage of variable templates, constexpr, and generic lambdas. Control flow is implemented using generic lambdas and static if. I have very little explicit specialization. And I use Y combinators to implement loops and recursion. I also have a namespace-oriented usage syntax where the list data structure is actually a namespace. And I have list, colon, colon, make, list, and colon, long contains, which I think is very nice in terms of syntax. The list is implemented as an std tuple. And I've just learned from Louis' talk that it's very inefficient. So I'll be looking to replace that. I wanted to use HANA for this project, but it wasn't supported by GCC 5.x. Now GCC 6 supports HANA, so I will be probably removing my own metaprogramming module and use HANA instead, which is...
What does support HANA?
GCC 6.
So, and also what?
Clang. Clang.
Oh, okay.
Clang, yeah. So the list is very simple. It supports every kind of operation you expect on a compile time list. The cool thing is that I can use generic lambdas in compile time computations. So here, for example, L0 is a list of compile time values. L1 will filter the list using a lambda, which is still being executed at compile time. And then if I want to use the result of the filter in a template or somewhere that I require like something in angle brackets, I can force constexpr by using decal type of the type of on the result of the filter and instantiating it again. So I can use the result at compile time. The implementation is very simple. It's just a tuple, and that's it. Use cases in the framework are for the signature lists of components and systems. They are lists which are tuples, and I iterate over them by applying the tuples to functions, so variadic functions. So I get this list of signatures, I apply it to a variadic function, and so that I can iterate over every single signature. And again, I wanted to show you the forcing constexpr trick that I use to make use of lambdas. So here I want to find something in a list, and I want to return null, some kind of null tag, if it's not in the list. Otherwise, I want to return the index of the item if it's in the list. And I want to implement that nicely without any kind of specialization or something like that. So I use static if. Static if has to take some generic lambdas as the branches. And we know that lambdas are not allowed in constexpr expressions. So how can I force constexpr? It's simple. I just use decal type on the result of the function and instantiate the type that is returned by decal type. So I have like runtime syntax for compile time computations, which is very nice.
Did you know there's constexpr if that was accepted now? So
yeah.
At least in 17, you won't have to do that.
So the comment is that constexpr if was accepted in C++ 17. And tomorrow in my static control flow talk, I actually have some it's not slides, it's code. Some code dedicated to constexpr if where I show the history of the proposal. So yeah, that's pretty much it. Just some resources that are very interesting. So tmachine.org is a blog that's focused on entity component systems and has a lot of very interesting articles. All these links here are very, very interesting if you want to learn more about component-based design and communication techniques between components and entities. I've also analyzed some existing ECS libraries that are C++ 11 and 14. For example, Pronto uses compile-time entities, like the entities themselves are at compile time, which do not allow adding or removing components at runtime, which is a novel approach. Diana here uses sparse sets heavily for any kind of entity ID management and component ID management. Entity X uses compile-time components and events, so it doesn't use systems and proxies to allow communication between components. It has actually like an event bus, and you can add events and then do something depending on the events you got. This blog post here by Mike Klein is called The General Design of My Flow Compile-Time Entity Component System in C++ 14. And I was surprised when I found this link on Reddit, because it's very, very similar to my implementation, and I had no idea about it. And he mostly talks about the difficulties in metaprogramming what I implemented with type value encoding. And it's very interesting to see his approach. If I'm not mistaken, he actually passed to D, because he preferred the syntax for metaprogramming, and is now implementing a similar system in D.
That's
so
what makes it flawed.
Sorry?
I said that's why it's flawed.
And I talked about entity component system at CPPCon 2015. It was much more limited. It was single-threaded component systems. Had a lot of feedback and interesting discussions. So if you want to know more about that, check out that Reddit thread. It's full of interesting discussion. This is a Stack Overflow question that I posted. And here we have various algorithms to generate that callback chain with when I'll end up then continuations. So if you want to do something like that for your tasks, if you have the need of using SED future or boost future, that's very, very interesting. And the second question is is similar to the solution I'm using with a simple counter and decrementing the counter when a dependency is over. So that's the simple solution. Future ideas. I currently don't have any way of dealing with vectorization and SIMD operations. That depends on the storage strategy of the components. So I suppose the only way of implementing that is having special components with some kind of metadata that allows the storage to reorder them in order to use SIMD upon them. I haven't thought much about it, but I know it's important, so I will spend some time on it. Also, another thing is matching system subtasks to other system subtasks without having a join step. So maybe we don't care about all the entities in a system. We only care about the subtask, and we want to directly match subtask with another subtask. I don't know how to implement that because it assumes that the strategy for parallelism is the same for both systems, and I'm not sure it's very useful because I cannot think of a motivating example. But Intel TBB supports it, so there has to be some interesting use case for that.
You would just as easily combine the two systems into one system.
Yeah, that's actually, the comment is you could just combine the systems into one system. That's what I would do. I mean, I have to think about it. Another thing I want to find is an alternative to deferred functions, because TD function has a significant overhead. An idea would be have some kind of command queues that are maybe algebraic types, which are very lightweight. And I don't know how I would implement that, because the cool thing about a CD function is that you can assume that you have the memory and you can access the component memory and mutate it. So that's something to think about. I'm leaning towards move-only functions, like buffer CD functions that can only be moved, which could be more efficient and avoid the allocation overhead. As you have seen, most of my library revolves around settings at compile time, and all of those are hard-coded. I'd like to look into the possibility of development of generic settings and signature library, where you can specify the schema of your settings, and it will automatically give an error if the user as an invalid setting. You can specify constraints and just a library to create compile time settings libraries. So, and I also want to allow the refresh step to be customized. We may want to execute a function when we subscribe or unsubscribe an entity to a system. So I need a way to inject some kind of function when we do that. And I still need to think about it. I was talking about a different branch for the execution of the systems. And this is how it looks like. This is currently in development. And as you can see, we have an additional layer of abstraction here. We can specify where we want to start the execution. So if we have separate chain, we simply say we want to start by the physics system. We want to start by the rendering system. And also, as you can see here, we have this executor object that's we can query for the subtasks, but we can do things that are not into the subtasks themselves. So some preparation steps and some final steps. Another very important thing I have to do is benchmark. I haven't had time to set up proper benchmarks. I want to see the trend of parallelism, both outer parallelism and inner parallelism, and how it scales with the number of cores. I have to do that very carefully. I want to get some meaningful data, so I have to work on that. So that's the end of the talk. If you have any question, please go ahead.
Okay. So a lot of the threading stuff you have is basically re-implementing a join fork system.
Yes.
So have you looked into using an existing join fork like HPX or TBB?
So the question is that most of the stuff I have for my multithreading details It's just an implementation of fork join system. And I've looked into TBB. I decided against it because my first idea was the callback chain with when all had done. So I tried to implement an algorithm to generate that. I did something that kind of worked, but it was inefficient. Then I found out about the counter method, which is very simple. And in that moment, I didn't need a library anymore because, as you can see, it's like 20 lines of code.
It just occurs to me that a lot of this might be more efficient if you have a good work stealing thread pool, because work stealing thread pool,
okay,
in this case, for example, if you have two system executions in parallel that split into subtasks, then a work stealing thread pool tends to keep the tasks of one system localized to a few cores and tasks of the other localized to a few cores,
okay,
which improves cache behavior.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I don't have any kind of work stealing in my thread pool implementation. I strive for simplicity. The best thing to do, in my opinion, would be what you suggested earlier, to let the user define its own thread pool or pass its own thread pool as a parameter so that we can make use of any more sophisticated thread pooling system. Yeah.
And what about HPX?
I haven't tried HPX, sorry.
Because HPX, that was exactly what you show about the tax pool, but with a future interface, like installed.
Okay.
And the override, you can see boost future and std future is totally removed.
Okay.
You have exactly the task what you need for it.
Okay.
A future implementation.
So the interface is like a future, but the implementation is not future.
No, the implementation is not thread, but lightweight thread.
Okay, perfect. So the comment was that HPX may be very interesting for the project because it's pretty much what I'm doing. It has a future-like interface, but it's very lightweight. So it could be a pretty good replacement for my code. Any more questions?
And also, they implement the parallel for each, which will be accepted for C++.
17, yeah.
And this is really useful for your inner parallelism stuff.
Okay, so the other comment was that HPX implements the parallel for each, which will be part of the C++ 17 standard, and this will be really useful for the inner parallelism stuff. And I agree, I will look into that. Thank you. That's it. Thank you again for coming.